Viewer discretion is advised.
The league by promptly having the worst record the NHL has ever seen. The year you won the President's Trophy, you lost to the 8th-seeded Duck. And that time you blew a 3-0 lead to your most hated rival, the Kings. And of course you finally made it to the finals and, well, you got your doors blown off. Hasso Plattner is a native of Germany who co-founded software industry monolith SAP, which is fitting the Sharks play in the SAP Center. Does SAP crash as much as the Sharks do?
Replacing the Cal Palace, SAP Center, known as the Shark Tank, will celebrate its 25th year this season. An actual Shark Tank was added in 2017, which is in the BMW Lounge. SAP essentially owns the team, not the Kings, people. Not the Kings.
Be asking yourself how the Sharks already have a legacy of failure around their neck. But when you combine a former NHL team, it comes more into view. The Oakland Seals are promoted from the WHL and are projected by most pundits to run away with the fledgling Western Conference. They immediately disappoint and finish last in the league. Great start, boys. The Seals need to appeal to a wider audience. It's time to rebrand as the California Seals and attract the Bay Area. It doesn't work. The team plays in front of tumbleweeds and crickets. Fortunately for them, no one notices as they are blown aside in the first round for two consecutive years. Good news, Seals. You've been purchased by the avaricious snake oil salesman Charles Finley. It's time to experiment with new branding. You are now the California Golden Seals. Brace yourselves for the majesty of the white skates. Turns out your loophole of getting into the playoffs is gone, and you're welcome back to last place in the NHL. At least you've got the first overall pick in the draft. Oh, you traded it to the Canadiens to draft a guy that doesn't play a game for you and a role player that's gone in 2 years. Well, let's hope this Guy Lafleur guy doesn't turn out to be any good. So your owner is a cheap piece of shit and won't match contracts. Enjoy the majority of your better players fucking off to the greener pastures of the WHA. You are not only in the basement, you are the basement. You're the walking joke of the NHL, a team that shuffles through coaches, owners, players, and relocation rumors like a deck of cards. The players hate it, the fans hate you, and you're losing. The league is tired of owning you. You may be contracted, and you're being run like a clown show. This sort of ineptitude is a generational talent. A last-ditch effort to keep the team in California rears its head. A proposal is in the works for a new stadium in San Francisco, and the team is getting better. Fingers crossed. Like the team's hopes, the stadium proposal fell through and the Seals are defecting from the Golden State. They're moving to Cleveland! Or should I say in the middle of nowhere 30 minutes away from Cleveland? They learned nothing from earlier, did they? Congratulations! The venture to Cleveland has been a total disaster and the team is bleeding millions of dollars. You get the reward of contraction. What was once the Cleveland Barons is being assimilated with the Minnesota North Stars. So what does the Seals' failure have to do with this current saga? For this, we have to advance to the early 1990s. The Gund brothers were former minority owners of the Seals and are suffering an existential crisis as part owners of the North Stars. They desire to bring NHL hockey back to the Bay Area. The league disapproves moving the North Stars, but awards them with a new team to return to their old home and continue their legacy of hockey. Dispersal and expansion drafts are done with them in Minnesota. Shoot, they're even playing in the old Cow Palace where the Seals used to play in the 1960s. In a roundabout way, the Oakland Seals are reborn as the Sharks. The team falls to shit out of the gate and becomes one of the great punching bags in the NHL for its first few years. A team so abysmal that they set the goddamn league record for losses in a season. At least the Cow Palace is pretty rocking. That and Doug Wilson's slapshot are the only good things of note so far. The Sharks are the incredible surprise of the league, led by 2/5 of the Red Army line and a young core. They're going to the playoffs. Impressive.
He's all alone, he'll push it to the corner, chase after it. Trailing is Baker, they score!
Did you just completely embarrass the Red Wings and add to Stevie Y's impeccable choking legacy? I'ma buy these fuckers around if I see them. The hockey gods wrap a beautiful bouquet for you in the form of blowing a 3-2 series lead to the Maple Leafs. Sucks, but it's a great season for you guys. Keep it going.
Here's Makarov. To the net. They score!
And they did it again! Nothing can stop the Sharks now. Unfortunately, the Red Wings are seeking revenge after last year's embarrassment. They show no mercy, rape the women, enslave the inhabitants, rage you of all valuable resources, raise everything to the ground, and salt the earth so nothing will ever grow again. Have a nice day. What, you thought it was kidding? Most of the Sharks' top players are gone, the coach is offered a sacrifice, and they're a punching bag again. A lone drifter approaches you in the abyss and offers his services. His name? Patrick Marleau. Might as well let him join you. You're able to recover quickly and make the playoffs just in time to lose to your old blood brother and the Stars in six games. Take a trip to the Rocky Mountains and get suffocated by the Avalanche in the playoffs the next year.
Hit by Lowry, and that freed it up for Nolan. Nolan's got plenty of time, and score!
This team may be mediocrity defined, but by God, do they have a flair for the dramatic. They just beat the President's Trophy winner and allowed us to laugh at the Blues again. Kudos. You get a tasty treat in being beaten to a pulp by your older brother again. Timu fucking Salane. You got yourself a great player. Now go make some noise. Ironically, the Blues are also looking for revenge after last year's defeat. They don't ravage everything, but they release the gas and suffocate them in six games. The team's got moxie, gusto, skill, and potential again. You won the Pacific Division and another playoff series. Your time is now. That's what we all thought. The offense turns into goop, scoring one goal in the final two games against the Avs and pisses away the series. Let's hope this is just a fluke. Games 6 and 7 are a microcosm of what is to come. The team falls apart and doesn't even make the playoffs. The corpses of Daryl Sutter and Dean Lombardi are paraded throughout the town square for a week. Ron Wilson got the train back on track. You have the best regular season you've ever had. You made it to the conference finals easily. You're taking on an underdog in the Flames. And you choke by losing in 6. Even worse, it's to that third-string goaltender you traded for a draft pick. How do you not win at home? All that chowder has made Boston lose their goddamn minds and trade you Jumbo Joe Thornton for a few depth pieces. Should be smooth sailing now. Alright, everything is going to plan. You breeze through the first round and have a commanding 2-game lead on the 8th-seeded Oilers. You're on a 6-game winning streak. No mercy. You lost 4 in a row? What the fuck, Sharks? I didn't know you were into nuclear meltdowns! Okay, you're back. You got the prizes of the deadline in Craig Rebay and Phil Guerin. You obliterate the Predators again. You've got a 2-1 series lead against the Red Wings with home court. Get it done. What do you mean they lost their next 3? I know it's the Empire, but fuck! That first round pick you traded for Rebay became Max Pacioretty. Montreal is still fleecing you after all these years, huh? Hold up, I'm not finished. That first round pick you gave up for Guerin became David Perron. Regardless, you're a goddamn juggernaut again. Second best record in all of the NHL. Your stars are gods. You've got veteran leadership in Jeremy Roenick, and you nab Soupy at the deadline. Don't blow it. And look at that, you lose to Patient Zero again. You know what? You want to deal with the pain of a 4 overtime loss? Have one, you underachieving sacks of shit. Couldn't have happened to a better bunch of fuckwits. President's Trophy winner. You're the heavy cup favorite. All of your stars are in their prime. Rob Blake is now on board. Now don't fucking fail me again. You lose in the first round. In 6 games. To the Mickey Mouse organization known as the Ducks. Excuse me while I drink this bleach. Take 6. Danny fucking Heatley. You're loaded with enough talent to cause someone to spontaneously combust. You actually end up making it to a hot date with the Blackhawks in the conference finals. This should be a great series. Did I say great series? I should have said embarrassingly swept into the pits of hell. They made it back to the conference finals again. Your forward core is stacked, your defense is loaded, and your goalie is a new stud in Antti Niemi. This has to be the fucking year to do it. The world has stabilized as San Jose fell apart again and got blown out of the water by the Canucks. I ran out of liquor a while ago. Back to the bleach. Before I do, they pull off a trade with Minnesota to bring in this guy named Brent Burns. This ought to bolster them up more than Charlie Coyle could. The misery continues in a first-round loss to the Blues. They hadn't won a playoff series in 10 years. I'm going to combine this bleach with ammonia now. The Sharks are loading up at the deadline again by acquiring a pest in Rafi Torres. I said pest, not axe murderer. It is time. You can finally dethrone the Kings as champions of the West. All you need to do is win a Game 7 on their ice. Hey, you remember when the Sharks didn't shit the bed in big games? Those were the days. Well done, Sharks. You're finally crushing that King's menace by humiliating them in three straight games. You know what to do. Sweep the fucking leg. Finish them. You got blown the fuck up. Okay, listen. Not that big of a deal. A sweep may have been ambitious. You're heading back home. Momentum can change on a dime in this league. Regroup and take them out there. You got this. Really? This how we're doing shit now? Don't do it. Don't go full Sharks on us again this year, boys. Especially not to a division rival. If you piss this away, you may as well delete the franchise again. For the love of God, don't make me say it! That Kings team goes on to win the Stanley Cup. You get a trophy of bubonic plague. We need scapegoats for this ineptitude. Time to castigate Marlowe and Thornton in the market square. They choose not to wait until April to kill off your dreams and proceed to self-immolate during the regular season. It's pretty insightful. You can't choke in the playoffs if you don't even make them. But you know what? Rafi Torres is coming back. And he tried to kill someone again. So you're saying Thornton and Marlowe are still here? Well, this is awkward. At least you made the playoffs again. Oh god, here we go. You're on your way to collapsing against the fucking Kings again. Just get it over, you're not choking. You're about to lose to the Predators? They haven't even made it past the second round in their existence, for God's sake. Don't tell me you're going to, you're not choking. You did it. You made the finals. Finally, a chance to shed the miserable choker label once and for all and emerge as a champion. You've exceeded every expectation placed upon you this year and have a chance to enter the halls of greatness. Every single failure finally swept clean and a chance to avenge your fallen comrades back to the days of the Seals. Get it done. The Sharks are completely outplayed thanks to a stubborn Peter DeBoer and are pecked to death by the fucking Penguins. Hold your heads high though. You can now boast that you have more playoff success than the Blues and Capitals combined. New year, fresh start. It's time to atone for last year's cup defeat. Oh my good lord, you lost to the Oilers in the first round? Fuck this franchise. It's like watching Groundhog Day without the humor. And now Patrick Marlowe is gone. You are now a dark horse candidate for a cup run. Evander Kane went from a head case and a half to the next great wingman. They walk into Anaheim and enjoy the delicacy of roast duck. So who are they playing in the next round? The Vegas Golden Knights? Come on, they are going to lose to an expansion team. They lose to an expansion team. San Jose has its heart ripped out Kano style by their neophyte overlords. Only one word is uttered as they bleed out on the floor. Marc-Andre Fleury. I would comfort you Sharks fans, but unfortunately I already drank all of the bleach. I'm going to go off and die now. Maybe they can let me down on my funeral like they've done the past 15 years.
More expansion team crime. This is the only example of an epic beatdown where the victim actually led the game at one point. 2:51 into the first period, Johan Garpenlöf scored on the power play, and that was about all the fun the second year Sharks would have, as the Flames scored 13 unanswered goals, 6 in the last period. Ron Stern and Robert Reichel both had hat tricks, and Theron Fleury had a plus minus of plus 9. But hey, Sharks, at least you tried.
Already shorthanded, late in the third period in a rivalry game in 2012, the Kings were on a break until Ryan Klo took a swipe at the puck from the bench and broke up the rush. Yeah, he wasn't coming onto the ice early. He literally swiped at it from the bench. And he received neither a penalty nor a suspension for this. Come on, Stripes, that's cheating.
I can't tell if this is a killer whale, a dolphin with teeth, or a very punchable land shark. Either way, SJ Sharky does indeed have more teeth than Brent Burns. In 1999, SJ tried to rappel from the ceiling and got caught up there. I like how they continued the pregame lineups and the national anthem while he dangled. If he dies, he dies, I guess. It took 20 minutes to finally get him down.
This goddamn team. Every time you try to have some shred of hope, they'll find a way to fuck it all up. I've seen this result every single year, yet I'm the dumbass that keeps coming back to them. It's borderline abuse. How many ways can they beat the life out of us? Own goals to clinch a series, offenses going dry, choking in the first round as a President's Trophy winner, quadruple overtime goals against? Notice how I didn't mention a certain event against LA. Fuck that, that series is dead to me. It's not enough to dwell on the past, because let's be real, Sharks fans are still living in it. We keep thinking to ourselves, don't worry, we may have fallen short again, but they're still in good shape. They've got talent, they've got Doug Wilson, they've got development, they've still got Jumbo Joe, we're good! That was until this year. Now the cold reality of having to pay the piper for years of kicking the can down the road is coming to roost. This is why I hate them. Doug Wilson may be a good GM, but he's been stricken with a debilitating case of Illich syndrome. It's what happens when a team sniffs or gets close to championship glories, but then proceeds to throw all caution into the wind in an effort to chase after it. Sadly, it usually doesn't end well. The Detroit Tigers can let you know of that tale. The problem with Wilson is an issue that many GMs come to deal with when a team is successful. They do everything they can to try and keep the gang together. It sounds nice and is a good story, but you know who doesn't give a shit about sentimentality? Father Time. He is ruthless and gives zero fucks. He only cares about moving forward, be it whether or not a team had their shot or not. San Jose had their chance. They failed. It was less of a showing and more in the style of being tactically spanked. Peter DeBoer never adjusted to the Pens' style of play and paid the price. They had strengths, especially in board play, but they never capitalized on it. The only reason this series didn't end sooner was because Martin Jones played eons over his head. It merely delayed the inevitable. Sharks lose, Pens win the cup, the world hates San Jose, wash, rinse, repeat. That's why you have to make your chances count. If not, you will turn into the Sharks. The last few years have been the standard fare. They have strong regular seasons, yet something always goes awry come playoff time, like always. Sharks are good? Well, here's a white-hot Vegas team that comes from nowhere. People salty that the refs allegedly handed you two straight playoff series wins? Their fans will beat themselves senseless due to what they think is karma. The playoffs are brutal, and as Doug Wilson said, it's like Lucy with the football. Instead of missing, they choke on the air as they're running. It's the worst feeling in the world. Being so close to an achievable goal, yet never getting there. What's the main response of anyone at this point? Throwing everything they can to finally get over the hump. Even if it means long-term sacrifice, the championship makes it all worth it. The band has to be kept together, rewarding the past with security in the future. Doubling down on the core is a dangerous game. On one plane of thought, loyalty. These men led you through thick and thin. So many fan favorites here. Could you imagine Jumbo Joe in a different uniform? Everyone cried when Marlowe left, so you gotta keep him around. He's at least earned that right, hasn't he? The downside? Well, look at these players. Brent Burns, Mark Edward Vlasic, Martin Jones, Evander Kane, Logan Couture. A lot of talent in that group, I must admit. But here are the contract lengths they were signed to. And here are the ages of each player when those terms expire. Notice something? Most of them are ending in their mid to late 30s. There's a hidden price to pay to keep the gang around. In this case, it's in paying for their declining years. Brent Burns has never given a shit about the word defense. His value comes in his offensive skill and production. Both are starting to take a nosedive, with both the eye test and analytically. 5 more years of this. With Vlasic, the same thing is happening. Physical skills declining, increasingly unable to keep pace with younger players. Some are even calling his deal one of the worst in hockey. By the way, he has 6 years left on his. Evander Kane is still in his prime, so at the very least his skills won't fall for a few years, but he plays a very physical game. What are the first skills to atrophy? Physical attributes. Pray it doesn't happen in the next 5 years. Martin Jones. This is the first year he's truly been consistent. The bad part is that he's been consistently horrible. A total liability, and Eddie's been told to hit the pine more often than not. By the way, you have him for 4 more years. Logan Couture is at least a bright spot, a man who's blossomed into a captain. He started an 8-year contract this season, but he should be fine, as long as the injuries don't get to him. Please. There is one more weapon to go over, though. Eric fucking Karlsson. His skating instincts and puck skills are legendary. At least before a severe foot injury nerfed one of his greatest strengths, but he's still really good. Think of what he could do with Vlasic or Brent Burns. Ottawa's selling off everything, so fuck it, it's worth a shot. His year as a Shark was iffy, but it's not like they're going to do something really desperate. Oh, god damn it. $11.5 million per year. For 8 years. For a guy who hasn't been anywhere near healthy for the past 2 seasons. Doug Wilson hasn't just lost the plot, he's been consumed by the Ring of Power. Somewhere I can see him looking to a Palantir and Sauron talks to him and says, Doug, sign all of your aging core to 8-year contracts. You're this close to a cup, fuck the future! Here's the thing, this contract will end up being worth it if you're getting Prime Karlsson. There's nothing over the past few years that's shown me that he's going to, if ever, return to his old form. He still has his instincts and puck-moving ability, but his skating is ruined. Look at how he's exposed nowadays. Is this worth $11.5 million a year to you? Hell, I'm a fan of Carlson, and even I can't justify giving him that deal. And wouldn't you guess it, he suffered another long-term injury. This time in a different location. Great. Of course, it was choosing one pill or the other. The cost came in being forced to let go of Joe Pavelski. Say what you will about his declining statistics in Dallas this year, but that man was the heart and soul of this franchise. Look at how the team rallied around him after he was injured in Game 7 against Vegas. You can't replicate that. Carlson doesn't have the tenure here to come close to that impact. Now, I'm not salty that he's no longer the captain. Couture earned the seat with his performance in last year's playoffs, but that loss is felt in a locker room. So now we get to see the Sharks trot out Jumbo Joe and Patrick Marleau for their fourth final tour of duty. Look, I love them as players. They're future Hall of Famers, their jerseys will be hanging from the rafters someday, but they're done. Marleau can at least keep pace, but he's a bottom six forward right now, not a core contributor. Thornton? The guy can barely skate. The knee injuries have taken their toll. I know he says he can play a few more years, but I just can't see it. Here's what you have to understand. I wouldn't be bitching all that much if this season was any good. Would you be shocked to know the alarming reality of this situation? It's not due to any particular player or unit or the stubborn mule known as Peter DeBoer. It's goddamn everything. The only way this core is able to thrive is if it continually brings in fresh talent that somehow emerges as quality depth. The Sharks always did this. Today, that well has run dry. The players they expected to develop haven't done so, and the guys they were counting on have experienced massive regression. Timo Meier, hell of a player last year. Now he's back to his cock-teasing ways. The dude didn't show up for a whole month. Tomas Hertl was great, and now he's gone. A bottom six? What the hell is that? Here's a rotating chorus of young dudes. Please let someone stick. Why are you telling me this defense can't do a damn thing without Radim Simic on it? Really? What about Kevin LeBanc and that ridiculously cheap contract of his? You know the one-year deal grossly underpaying him? He has somehow played down to it. I would be remiss if I said all of these facts weren't the worst thing to happen to the Sharks this past year. You see, in Doug Wilson's relentless descent into managerial illness, draft picks and prospects have become endangered species. Trading for Kane cost them a first-round pick in 2019 after re-signing him the previous year. The Carlson trade had them trading a former first in Josh Norris. Guess what one of the conditions was for re-signing him? Yes, a first-round pick. And it's in an incredibly deep draft with no lottery protections. This was supposed to be a fleecing of Ottawa. Now they may end up getting Lafreniere or Byfield from the pick. Thank God they didn't make the cup final last year or else they'd be giving up another first-round pick. As I said earlier, Father Time does not care if a team was successful or not in their window. No matter what, everyone must pay up. This is looking more and more like the Sharks' time. Even by trying to fire Peter DeBoer in an attempt to spark the team, it's too late. There was only failure. San Jose is looking straight in the barrel that the Kings and Blackhawks did before them. Fortunately for them, those teams won cups. They can at least go to the bottom of the ice rink with hardware in tow. What do the Sharks get? Fuck all. And it may end up costing Doug Wilson his job. Knowing this team's fortunes, he'll get another chance somewhere and lead that team to a cup like the previous GM did for a team further south. I expect nothing less from this goddamn club. Always teasing you with talent, they whisper that this is the year things change. This is the year we get over that damn hump. Sure as hell looks like it, boys. The only thing I wish was that it slowly let me down instead of chucking at me like a live grenade. Could you at least have done it in that way?
Not like this. Not like this.
We've spent too much goddamn time dealing with this team's bullshit to watch it all fall into the San Andreas fault. What's my motivation for following this team now? To see if Marleau can win a cup with the Penguins? Laugh at Tampa Bay for trading a first for Barclay Goodrow? Pray that everyone somehow turns 5 years younger? Bitch about the coronavirus all you want, but it gave the Sharks their best moment of the year. A mercy killing of this god-awful excuse of a season.